Welcome to this second lecture, popular science lecture for 2015 Nobel Prize. And this one is in physics. We're very lucky to have Professor Kam-Biu Luk to give this presentation. I don't think there's anybody more qualified than Kam-Biu to give this talk, maybe except the two Nobel laureates who won the prize this year, okay. Professor Luk is a professor of physics at University of California, Berkeley, and he's also a senior scientist at the Berkeley lab. And his work research is in neutrino oscillation, which is the topic here, and CP violation. He spent many years leading the effort in the neutrino oscillation experiment in China, together with Professor Yifan Wang. The collaboration involved around 30 university institutions worldwide, from mainland China, USA, Taiwan, Hong Kong, Russia, places. And that experiment measured one fundamental parameter of nature that was considered one of the major achievement in 2012. And I think he will give a talk tomorrow about the Diabe experiment tomorrow in the physics department. And he will lead a group of student faculty to go to look at Diabe experiment Saturdays, right? Which is about 50 kilometers from here. So it's a one-day trip. The experiment measured one of the fundamental parameters of nature as we know today. To the best we know, there's about 20 fundamental parameters of nature. That means everything else can be measured from that. Some of them you know very well. Newton's gravitational constant, speed of light, electron charge and mass, for example. And by now we have measured most of the parameters. And the one that Professor Luk and his team measured is one of the last ones to be measured. And the value is such that somewhat unexpectedly large, which opened the window for us to explore further that why our universe is made of matter and not antimatter, or why there's imbalance. So for that work, Professor Luk and Professor Wang won the Panofsky Prize a couple years ago. And in fact, just last week, he won the Breakthrough Prize in Fundamental Physics, together with actually the two Nobel laureates. He's gonna discuss their work. So let's thank Professor Luk.
Well, thank you for the nice introduction. I'm very happy that I can share some of the excitement about my field with you here. So as a researcher in neutrino physics, certainly I'm really pleased that this year the Nobel Prize in Physics goes to the discovery of neutrino oscillation. And I hope that in the remaining hour, I can convince you that indeed why Professor Kachita and also Professor McDonald deserve the recognition of this year. So first of all, you may wonder what a neutrino is. Now in particle physics, we consider the neutrino as a tiny and also shine the particle. So the important thing is for you to pay attention to these two adjectives, tiny and shy. So first of all, let me explain to you what we mean by a particle. Now probably many of you know that matter is made up of atoms. Now however, in particle physics, we do not consider atom as, okay, say, elementary particles. But instead, nowadays, okay, we know the atom is made of, okay, a cloud of electrons, you know, the enclosing, you know, the, a nucleus. If we look at the nucleus more carefully, then we have, you know, the proton and neutrons. And through, okay, a series of studies, now we know the proton and neutrons are also composite. As a matter of fact, okay, they are made up of, okay, the, you know, the quarks. So for instance, here, okay, the, we have the proton making up, okay, two, you know, up quarks and a down quark. And from experiments, now we know, that the quarks, along with, the electrons that we are familiar with, are not divisible anymore. So as a result, okay, these are considered as, okay, the fundamental building blocks of matter, you know, in particle physics. Now, then you may wonder, okay, why, okay, we should care about, okay, neutrinos. Now it turns out, okay, if we look around, then we find out actually, okay, we are essentially, okay, the living, okay, in a big giant soup of, neutrinos. So after, the Big Bang of the universe, then we have, okay, neutrinos, okay, left behind. As a matter of fact, now based on, okay, what we know about the universe, so if we, okay, have, okay, our tiny finger, you know, say sticking out, then we have about, okay, 300, you know, the neutrinos left over from the Big Bang, okay, going through, okay, say our fingernail. Now you may say, okay, well, okay, this is too far away, it has nothing to do with our daily life, then we can also, okay, consider another, okay, say the kind of, okay, neutrinos. Say for instance, okay, if we eat fruit, for breakfast, in particular, for instance, okay, if we say eat a banana, because, okay, it has, potassium 40, which is, okay, radioactive, then in a day, typically, then about, okay, a million, the anti-neutrinos, okay, will go through our body. So therefore, you can see, okay, that ultimately this, okay, is tied, okay, to, okay, our daily living. So now, I hope, you would begin to pay attention, say the neutrino. So then the question is, okay, you know, why do we need a neutrino at all? Now, it turns out, okay, if we go back, about, 100 years ago, roughly, then people, began, to study, radioactivities, and there are three kinds of, natural radiations. So the first kind is what we call, alpha particle. So for instance, here are two examples. You know, say if we live, in the basement or, deep underground, then we have heard about, radon gas. And the radon gas, is radioactive, and when it decays, then eventually, it will give rise to, the, polonium, the 218. And this, the nucleus is unstable. It will decay, to give us lead and, an alpha particle with, some amount of energy. Now, it turns out, from elementary physics, we know, if we have, an object decaying into, two other new particles, then the energy of, the daughter of the parent is shared by the two daughters, in a very unique manner. So as a result, if we do the experiment and measure, the energy of the alpha particle, then we'll see, they will take up, a well-defined energy. So for instance, for the first, decay, we know the alpha particle will have about 6 MeV. Indeed, experimentally, we observe that. And then for the second one, then you see, indeed, we observe about 7.7 MeV. So these are, essentially very well defined. Now, if you look at, the gamma ray decay, we see, something very similar. So essentially, we get, the gamma ray from the excitation of the americium nucleus to some lower state. So as a result, then you emit gamma ray with very well defined energy. So then again, you see all these spikes. So this will tell us some structure about the americium. However, if we now look at beta decay, then we get a very different story. So in the beta decay, usually what we do, you know, is to essentially measure, you know, the beta particle coming from, okay, say, the, you know, the parent decay. And you can see, okay, from experiment, certainly, you know, the distribution of the beta ray is not the same as, okay, say, the alpha decay or the gamma decay. Okay, we have a very broad, okay, the continuum. So then the question is, okay, why, you know, the beta decay is so different from, okay, say, the two other decays? It turns out, you know, the answer, you know, came from, you know, the a prominent physicist, okay, Pauli. So he proposed that the reason why, you know, that we have such a broad distribution for, you know, say, the beta ray is because actually, okay, in the decay, we do not have only two daughters, like, okay, say, the alpha or the gamma decays. However, it has, okay, one more additional particle, which is the electrical neutral, so it can escape, okay, from, you know, the apparatus. So as a result, we do not see this one. So because of, okay, the existence of, okay, the third particle, so as a result now, okay, it can share some of the energy with, you know, the beta ray. So therefore, now in this case, we do not see, you know, the spike anymore. So then the question is, okay, does neutrinos exist or not? So this was a burning question for a while. Now, naturally, okay, we want to, okay, experimentally confirm, okay, this, you know, speculation. However, okay, there's one, okay, major hurdle we have to overcome. It turns out, okay, the neutrino is very shy. It doesn't like to interact with matter that often. For instance, okay, recall, if we eat the banana, then we will get some neutrinos or antineutrinos coming out of our body. So now just imagine, say, somehow we could fill, okay, the entire universe with water, and then let, you know, the, one of the neutrino coming from the banana to go from Earth, okay, outward into space. Now, then we find out, okay, from calculation, this, okay, the neutrino can travel very, very long distance. As a matter of fact, roughly, you know, they can, it can travel, okay, hundreds of light years before, okay, it will run into, okay, a water molecule. So therefore, you can see, okay, in this case, why, okay, we are not killed by, okay, neutrinos when we, you know, have banana for breakfast, because, okay, it doesn't, you know, the light to, okay, say the, you know, collide with, okay, our atoms in our body. However, okay, this will be a chance because, okay, it takes, okay, the a very rare, okay, chance, okay, for us to see the neutrino. So in order to overcome, okay, this problem, then we need a very intense, okay, neutrino source in order to, okay, do experiment or to, okay, the discover, you know, the neutrino. So we fast forward now, okay, into, okay, the Second World War, in particular towards the second the end of the Second World War, okay, people, okay, the, you know, the realize we could control nuclear fission, which was used, okay, to make the atomic bomb. However, besides, okay, the atomic bomb, we can have the peaceful use of, okay, nuclear fission. In this case, then we realize, okay, nuclear reactor for generating electricity. Now, nowadays, if we, okay, say, look at a running nuclear reactor that can generate roughly about 1 gigawatt of electricity, which is good enough, okay, for, you know, say, the, you know, Hong Kong, the, you know, for maybe half a day or something like that, okay? It can then generate a lot of, okay, antineutrino every second. As a matter of fact, you can see, okay, it's about 10 to the, you know, 20th. So it's a huge number of neutrinos for us to do experiment. So therefore, even though, okay, the antineutrinos or the neutrinos do not want to interact with us, however, if we produce a lot of them, then there's a chance that, okay, we can see them. So this is very similar to, okay, say, when you pay, okay, say, you know, dart, you know, throwing dart on, okay, on a target. Naturally, okay, the more you throw, okay, the chance you hit one, okay, is higher. So we use, okay, the same idea. And in order, okay, say, to do this experiment in the towards the end of the Second World War, people, okay, essentially had to use, you know, the, you know, some nuclear plants, you know, that were used, okay, for generating, you know, uranium and you know, polonium for, you know, nuclear weapon. Now, however, to Professor Reines and his colleague, Cloud, they took advantage of, okay, say this kind of, okay, the nuclear pile to do the experiment. So in 1953 to 56 or so, they installed, okay, one experiment underground near the nuclear pile. And after, okay, you know, a couple of years, so finally they observed, okay, evidence indicating, okay, they have observed, okay, the, you know, say the neutrino, which is indicated, okay, by little goats, because, okay, the, it's very hard not to see. So certainly, okay, this was a very exciting moment. Now, however, okay, it turns out, okay, that's not, okay, the end of the story. Then by, okay, the early 60s, we began, okay, to have, okay, relatively powerful nuclear accelerator, built, okay, in many different locations. So one particular one was, okay, the one accelerator, in the Brookhaven National Laboratory. And at that time, okay, people realized that, okay, there could be another kind of, okay, neutrino besides, okay, the one that, okay, Professor Reines, okay, discovered using, okay, nuclear reactor. So in order, okay, to confirm, okay, say, you know, that speculation, then people, okay, perform an experiment like this. So what we do now is use, you know, the relatively high energy proton beam hitting, okay, a target. So it can be, you know, just a piece of metal or whatever. And then sometimes, okay, the proton will interact with, you know, the atoms or the nuclei inside, you know, the target, and then produce a bunch of, okay, secondary particles. In particular, most of them are what we call, okay, pions that are not stable and decay into, you know, so-called the muon, and then also, okay, the another neutrino. So this is, okay, say the neutrino that people, okay, want to study. Now, in order for us to, okay, study the neutrino, what we need to do is to filter out, okay, all this, pions and muons and so on. So therefore, what they do is, okay, behind, you know, say this shielding, they put, you know, say the detector there. Now this is, okay, the picture, okay, showing, okay, the actual, okay, the apparatus with Professor, okay, Schwartz, okay, standing by it. So you can see, you know, the essentially a lot of the particle tracks, you know, corresponding, okay, to some of the muon, okay, going through. However, once in a while, this, okay, neutrino from, you know, the pion decay can interact inside, okay, the detector and give a reaction. And what they discover, surprisingly, is this. This, okay, neutrino coming from, okay, say the pion decay, okay, will only, okay, associate with, okay, a muon. Whereas, okay, Professor, you know, the Reines, neutrino should give you, okay, electron instead. So therefore, this is very different from, okay, say, you know, the one discovered in the 50s. So as a result, then we know there are actually two kinds of neutrinos. So I use, okay, a second label to representing, okay, this one. And then if we now fast forward to, okay, the beginning of this millennium, then some of my old colleagues, they mounted an experiment at Fermilab, and they discovered, okay, say the tau neutrino. So nowadays, okay, altogether we know there are three kinds of neutrino: the electron type, the so-called the muon type, and the tau type. And so far, okay, the discoveries of the first two types of neutrinos, you know, are recognized with, okay, the, you know, Nobel Prizes. So you can see, okay, the all the gentlemen. So this is Professor Reines, and this is, okay, the, you know, the other you know, team leaders. Now, after, okay, we have, okay, say the evidence that neutrino exists, then we can begin to study its, you know, properties. So the first thing we can do is to find out, okay, how heavy, okay, this neutrino is. For instance, okay, we know the electron certainly has some, okay, finite mass. You know, it has, okay, some weight. So then the question is, okay, how about, okay, say the neutrino? Now it turns out, okay, in order to measure the mass of the neutrino is very tricky. So what we need to do is this. At least, okay, this is, okay, still not the standard approach. is to look at, okay, say the beta ray coming from radioactive isotope. Now, if we now look at, okay, say the distribution of the beta ray, in particular, look at, okay, say the end of, okay, the distribution. This corresponds to the maximum energy of, okay, the beta ray that can take up when we have the decay. If we blow up, okay, say this, okay, tiny part, then we see, okay, if the neutrino is massless, then we expect, okay, it will follow, okay, red line like this. On the other hand, if the neutrino has, okay, some finite mass, then essentially, okay, it will take up, okay, some of the energy, according to Einstein, say famous equation, mass equals to mc squared. I mean, energy equals to mc squared. So therefore, okay, in this case, we expect now the beta ray will have less maximum energy. So as a result, then, okay, if we look at, okay, say the distribution of the beta ray, then we see, okay, it will end, okay, earlier than, okay, what it would be if, the neutrino is massless. So experimentally, then what we need to do is to try to measure the beta ray carrying, okay, say the highest energy, okay, it can have, okay, from the decay. Now experimentally, this is, okay, what we observe. So all this, okay, say dots are experimental point, and okay, the solid line essentially, okay, represent, say our expectation corresponding to, okay, say roughly zero mass. And you can see indeed, okay, that the data is consistent with, okay, say a very light or, okay, zero mass, okay, neutrino. As a matter of fact, okay, towards the 1950s, Professor Li and Yang, they wrote a paper and proposed that, okay, the neutrinos should be massless. And this, okay, the hypothesis, okay, has been built into the so-called standard model in particle physics, okay, for, say the last several decades. So this is, okay, something now very important that you have to keep in mind. So up to this point, we believe, okay, or we assume the neutrinos, okay, are massless. Now, on the other hand, we can also use the neutrinos, okay, for some, okay, the good use. In particular, because, okay, it's so weakly interacting, so it can be used, okay, to study the internal structure of the sun. In particular, for instance, if we want to find out, okay, how much energy the sun can generate through, okay, nuclear fusion right at the center. And in this case, now according to our understanding of the sun, through the fusion process, then neutrinos, okay, should then come out from the center of the sun, okay, radiating in all directions, and then some of them, okay, should, okay, come to Earth. As a matter of fact, based on, okay, say this, okay, standard model of the sun, then we expect, okay, that every second we have about, okay, 5 million neutrinos, coming through, okay, again, okay, a fingernail. So it's quite a large number. Now, so then the question is, okay, can we really see, okay, some of these neutrinos? Now, it turns out indeed, okay, we do see, okay, some of these neutrinos, or sometimes we call the solar neutrinos. So as a matter of fact, this is the image of the sun, by detecting the neutrinos coming from it. So we can see, it's rather fuzzy because, okay, that we do not have, okay, a lot of, okay, neutrino events, okay, here yet. However, it does, okay, point out something very important. Imagine, say, somehow we live in another universe that did not have neutrinos. Now, what we expect to see in the universe? It turns out in this case, this is the answer. Basically, there will be no nuclear fusion, there will be no sun, and we don't survive. So therefore, you can see the neutrino actually is very important to our existence. So now, in order, okay, to detect the solar neutrinos, again, remember, we have to, okay, use a very large target, because now in this case, the number of solar neutrinos we get every second is a lot lower than, okay, say the nuclear reactor. So therefore, in order to compensate our chance of, okay, say, seeing some reaction, then we need, okay, to have gigantic detectors. So the first generation of experiment detecting sonar neutrino was carried out by Professor Davis and his team using the, you know, Lotus, okay, about 600 ton of, okay, breaching the solution, put deep underground, is about, the 1.5 kilometer underground in order, okay, to see, the sonar neutrinos. The surprising thing is, okay, after many years of observation, Professor Davis concluded that the number of sonar neutrinos that he observed is about only 30% or so of, okay, the expectation. So the question is, okay, why they are so different? So this is, okay, that, you know, that's something that we have to address. And about, okay, say the same time, that is, okay, towards, okay, the end of, okay, the Professor Davis experiment, then people also, okay, the study the cosmic ray, in particular, the neutrinos, you know, coming from, okay, the atmosphere. Now, how do we get, say, neutrinos from the atmosphere? It turns out, okay, when we have a cosmic ray coming from outer space entering our atmosphere, then they can collide with the air molecules. And subsequently, just like, okay, what we have gone through, the accelerator, then the energetic cosmic ray will generate, the showers that are made up of, the, pions. They are then decaying, okay, give us muons, and then, okay, say the neutrino representing by the dotted lines here. Now, the muons and the neutrinos, then they can reach, okay, the ground level. As a matter of fact, they can even penetrate, through Earth. If we go deep enough, then, okay, we filter our, let's say, most of the muons, and then what's left, okay, will be, okay, neutrinos, coming from the atmosphere. And towards, okay, the end of, okay, say the last, okay, the millennium, there was one big experiment called, okay, Super Kam-Biu Luk in Japan. That was designed essentially, to look for unstable signal of, the proton. In other words, okay, the people, okay, to want to find out whether, okay, the proton, okay, is stable or, okay, the unstable or not. In order to do that experiment, then we have to have a very gigantic detector. For instance, okay, for the Super Kam-Biu Luk detector, which is still, okay, the largest one, okay, in the world, it's, okay, the 40 meter, okay, in height, and then about 40 meter, okay, in diameter. So this detector is located in, a mine, which is about a kilometer, okay, under the Japanese Alp right there. So this is near the central part of, okay, say, Japan. Now, using, okay, say, this detector, then they can do a lot of, okay, the, measurements. Now, to give you some idea about, okay, say, the, the size of this detector, this is, okay, picture probably, okay, some of you have seen. So inside, okay, this, okay, gigantic water tank, you see, okay, a lot of, okay, say, light bulbs. So this is, okay, what we call, okay, photo multiply tubes for detecting, the wave thin bursts of light. It can detect all the way down to, one single photon, much better than, okay, say, our eye. And also you can see, comparing with, okay, say, these two workers, okay, sitting, in a raft inside, okay, say, the water, you can see, okay, say, the size of it, of this detector. And furthermore, the detector has, okay, a lot of very pure water. So as a matter of fact, you can see, okay, this is, okay, the ultra pure water, and you can see, okay, essentially, okay, the bottom of them. So I was lucky, okay, one time I could stand, okay, on a platform, and look down, indeed, okay, seeing, okay, all the photomultiply tubes, okay, at the bottom. So just to show you, okay, how pure, how clean, the water is. Now, using such a big detector, then they can essentially, study the atmospheric neutrinos. Now it turns out, okay, there are two kinds of atmospheric neutrinos, okay, that we can obtain from the cosmic ray interaction in the atmosphere. The first kind is, okay, the electron neutrino. That is, okay, the one discovered by Professor, okay, Reines. And you can see, okay, when that neutrino interacts with the water, then you generate the electron. And when the electron goes through the water, then it will give out, okay, essentially a ring of light. This is what we call the Cherenkov radiation. Now, on the hand, if we have, okay, say the muon neutrino interacting inside the water tank, then it will give out a muon type of a particle. And in this case, this is, okay, say the Cherenkov ring, okay, emitted by the muon. And it turns out because the muon is a lot heavier than the electron, subsequently, it will have a very tight ring, okay? Whereas, okay, the electron, because it's very light, usually, when it goes through the water, it will bounce around. So as a result, then it will lead to this, okay, fussiness of, okay, say, the ring. So therefore, now by looking at the fussiness of the ring, then you can tell whether, okay, you have the muon type of, okay, interaction or the electron type. Well, once, okay, you can identify, okay, the type of events you have, then people then can count the number of muon neutrinos versus, okay, the number of, okay, electron neutrino type. Now, the surprising thing is they did not find anything, okay, unusual about the electron muon type, neutrino type, because, okay, the measurement agree with, okay, say, the prediction quite well. However, if you look at the muon type, then we have a different story. So the dots are the data point representing, okay, say the number of muon neutrino we have. Now the x-axis is, okay, say a function of, okay, so-called the azimuthal angle. So in other words, imagine, say, you draw, okay, a vertical line, and then now when you have, okay, say a neutrino coming in, then the angle between the vertical line and the neutrino is what we call, okay, say, the azimuthal angle. Now, when we look at, okay, say, the number of muon neutrino as a function of the cosine of this azimuthal angle, then you can see that the data points certainly do not look like, okay, say, the prediction, which is representing, okay, by this, okay, red line here. So then the question is, okay, what happened? Now, one interesting thing, okay, for us to keep in mind is this. For cosine theta equals to 1, that means, okay, essentially, the muon neutrino is going, okay, so-called, okay, the, top down into the detector and then going through Earth like this. Whereas, okay, for cosine theta equals to minus 1, then we have essentially the muon neutrino going from the South Pole through Earth and enters the detector. So it tells us, okay, from the data that somehow when the muon neutrino travels a long distance, then we see less. Whereas, okay, the other one, okay, you can see, okay, it's consistent with, okay, our prediction. So then the question is why? Now, this is, okay, essentially the speculation. So imagine, say, suppose, okay, the neutrino is just like, okay, say, one of the entertainer, wearing, okay, say, a face mask like this. And I'm sure some of you might have seen this. And during, say, the magic show, then, okay, the entertainer, essentially, in split second, can change, okay, the mask into another one. And then later on, okay, it can change, okay, again. So therefore, you can see, that the this, okay, say, person essentially, okay, changing, okay, his identity, okay, that at times goes by. Now, if we, okay, use, okay, this same analogy to look at, okay, say, what happens to neutrino, this is, okay, what we see. So imagine, say, at the beginning, we start off with, a certain number of electron neutrinos, and then wait for a while. Imagine, say, for instance, okay, they are going at some speed and some distance. You count the number of, okay, say, the electron neutrino, the white ghost. Now, if, okay, say one of them has changed the phase to, okay, another one, then naturally in this case, we'll see, okay, a few, okay, white goats. Now, this can continue, okay, as time goes by. So you can see now, okay, sometimes later, then they can, okay, you know, change back from, okay, to, say, the original one. However, the others, they can change the other types. So you can see now, if we, okay, continue with, say, this exercise, then basically, okay, that will explain why, okay, we will see less, you know, experimentally. In other words, okay, if some of them somehow, okay, change, okay, the identity by the time they reach, okay, detector, then certainly we will see, okay, less of them. Now, if we, okay, say, accept, you know, this, you know, hypothesis, then naturally, you know, okay, we want to see, you know, okay, what happens. You know, say, for instance, to, you know, say, apply it to, you know, say, the solar neutrino. Now, using, you know, okay, say, this so-called, okay, neutrino oscillation hypothesis, this is, okay, what we have. So this is, okay, the center of the sun. So based on, okay, what we know, through, you know, nuclear fusion, we will produce, okay, essentially only, you know, the electron type. Now, however, okay, when these, you know, electron neutrinos, you know, the emerge from, you know, the sun, it will go through, okay, somewhere dense, okay, the region. And this, okay, the dense region will enhance, okay, the transformation of the electron neutrino into, okay, other kind. So for instance, okay, say somewhere around, okay, 0.2 of the radius of the sun, then we see, okay, some of them now, okay, will become, okay, the tau type, and also some of them will become, you know, the muon type. And then as, you know, they escape from the sun, then, you know, the density of the sun get less and less. And in this case, then it will not affect, okay, say, you know, this, you know, three types of neutrinos anymore. So as a result, by the time, you know, they emerge from the surface of the sun, then they have, okay, essentially a very well-defined number for each type. Now, then the question is, okay, on Earth, can we somehow, you know, say, really count, you know, say, all these three types of neutrinos, okay, correctly? Then about, let's say about 20 something years ago, it turns out, okay, Professor Herb Chen came up with, okay, this, okay, brilliant ideas. Imagine, say, we can have a detector filled with, okay, heavy water, which is, okay, what we call the deuterium, D. Now, the deuterium is made up of, okay, a proton and a neutron. Now, if we have the solar neutrino of the electron type coming in, colliding with, okay, the deuterium, then it can break it up into a proton and a proton plus the electron. Now, another possible, okay, reaction inside heavy water is this: independent of the type of neutrinos we have, after they collide with the proton, the deuteron, then again it will break up into, okay, proton, neutron plus, okay, say, you know, the same type of neutrinos as the incoming. So therefore, you can see, okay, these two reactions are different. So we label this one, okay, it's called CC, actually represents, okay, so-called the charge current reaction. And this one, okay, represents so-called the neutral current reaction. Now, besides interacting with the deuterium nucleus, the deuteron, once in a while, the incoming neutrino, independent of the type we have, can collide also with the atomic electron. And they can perform, you know, essentially elastic scattering, just like, okay, we play in, okay, billet ball. Then after the reaction, okay, this is what we have. Of course, okay, now the atomic electron will get, you know, kicked out from the atom, so it will become a free particle. So this is what we call, okay, elastic, okay, scattering. Now using, okay, say this free reactions, then you can see each one will allow us to learn something. So this one will allow us to count the number of, okay, electron type of neutrino. Then these two will essentially count up, you know, say, the total number. Right? So once, okay, we have this, okay, right idea, then we can do the experiment. However, remember, the number of solar neutrinos, okay, we get in a second is very small. And we get a lot of, okay, the interference from cosmic ray. So as a result, in order to really perform the experiment using those three reactions, we have to go very deep underground. And it turns out, okay, we got lucky. And it turns out there's one very active nickel mine in Canada called the Sudbury Nickel Mine, which is about 2 kilometers underground. Right? So this, to give you some idea, in Canada, they have the CN Tower, which is about half a kilometer high. So therefore, you can see the size of this mine. Now, right at inside the mine, then people in the 90s installed a gigantic detector. So this is the conceptual drawing of it. You can see inside this detector, we have a big flask filled with 1 kiloton of heavy water, and then surrounded by pure water, essentially to protect any kind of natural radioactivity from the rock getting into our detector. So therefore, this detector right in the center is very quiet. So therefore, we can then do the experiment. Now, to give you some idea about what this detector look like, this is essentially a fisheye lens view. When you go look in through the chimney, down into the detector. So you can see, there is a big giant sphere here. This is made out of acrylic, the same kind of material we use aquarium, so that you can see the fish. But of course, in our case, we want to see the neutrino. Now, outside of the acrylic vessel, then you see a lot of photo multiply tube. As a matter of fact, this experiment, so-called the snow experiment, there are roughly about 10,000 photo multiply tubes serving as our human eyes watching for the neutrino reaction. And this picture, just to give you some idea about a whole container. So you can see how it looks like, and a human being is right there. So this is roughly I think 15 meters or so, in diameter. Now, after we fill the detector with heavy water, then you turn on the experiment. Then indeed, once in a while, we do see neutrino interaction. The reason is again similar to Super Kam-Biu Luk candidate. The electron, when it's moving fast enough, then you emit a chunk of light, so they will give you a circular disk like this. So again, by studying all these disks, then we can then count the number of neutrinos of the different type. At the end of the day, the snow experiment came up with this result. So let's see what we have here. Now, for the y-axis, this will essentially tell us the number of the muon and the tau type combined together. So this is essentially the intensity, how many we get for those two types. And then the x-axis corresponds to the electron type. Now, remember, altogether we have three reactions, so therefore, essentially, we will have three bands representing the result correlating the intensity of the electron type and the other twos. And you can see the color bands are for the three the reactions. So for the charge current type and then the elastic scattering. Remember, this is the one scatter off the atomic electron, and this is the neutral current giving you the proton and the neutron type. And the amazing thing is, this three bands intersect right here. This is the dot representing that this is really the answer of the experiment. That tells us essentially the amount of electron neutrino type. As a matter of fact, the number is given there. And then if we read off from the y-axis, that will give us essentially the number of the muon and the tau type given here. Now, when you add them up together, this will be the total number of neutrinos coming from the sun. We get about 5. About the theoretical calculation, we also get 5. So we are right on the dot. So this experiment essentially, okay, proves that there's nothing wrong with our understanding of the sun. What has gone wrong, you know, is because, okay, we didn't understand, okay, the neutrino that much. So because of, okay, this, okay, conclusive experimental demonstration, that's why, you know, the snow team, in particular, you know, the leader, you know, the, you know, Professor, okay, McDonald, okay, received the Nobel Prize of this year. So this experiment essentially, you know, convincingly showed that, you know, that we have neutrino oscillation. However, up to this point, all our, okay, say, evidence of neutrino oscillations come from neutrinos given by nature. In other words, we have no control. We cannot turn off the sun and see, okay, what happens, okay, to our detector. So in order to convince ourselves that neutrino oscillation is really, okay, say, the right, okay, explanation, then we have to essentially use, okay, man-made sources, in particular, you know, the, you know, using either accelerator or using, okay, the nuclear reactor. And I was very fortunate that at the beginning of the millennium, then I joined force with Professor Suzuki in, say, this Kamland experiment in Japan. So this is, okay, one of the five experiments receiving the breakthrough prize. So therefore, actually, I received two, you may say. All right? Because I'm a member of, okay, the Kamland experiment. So what we did was, okay, we used, okay, one of the cavern in the chemokine mine and install a gigantic detector, okay, show it here. This is, okay, a little bit different from the snow experiment because, okay, instead of, okay, using heavy water, what we have is, okay, a so-called liquid scintillator. So this is also, okay, you know, 1 kiloton in weight. So again, okay, if you, okay, look inside of the detector through the chimney, then this is what we have. Another difference between the Kamland experiment and also the snow experiment is that, okay, instead of having, okay, a cryo containing, you know, the target material, what we do is, okay, use, okay, a very thin piece of membrane. Essentially, okay, this membrane is as thin as, okay, our human hair. And we contain essentially this, okay, 1 kiloton of, okay, liquid inside to detect, you know, the antineutrinos. Now, you may not familiar with a liquid scintillator, so this is, okay, one picture showing, you know, what happens. So we have, okay, two samples here. The one to the left is just, okay, regular mineral oil. The other one is, okay, liquid scintillator. So when we illuminate them with ultraviolet light, then you can see, okay, that we don't see any kind of, okay, say, the emission from, okay, the mineral oil. However, from the scintillator, you see, okay, say, the, you know, the blue light coming out. So this is, okay, the scintillation. So instead of using, okay, say, the, you know, say, ultraviolet lamp like this, what we do is, okay, we let, you know, the neutrino to come into our detector and have interaction. Then after that, then we'll have charged particle produced and go through, okay, our detector. Then they will essentially excite, you know, the liquid scintillator and give out, okay, say, bursts of light. And all this, okay, the dots, the green dots, represent, okay, say, certain amount of light detected by, okay, the photomultiply tube. So what we do is, okay, by studying, okay, say, this kind of a heat pattern and also, you know, the time that we see, you know, the photons, then essentially we can deduce whether, okay, we have, you know, the neutrino interaction or not. Now, in 2003 or so, then we published, you know, the result from Kamland. But what I'm going to show you, okay, is, okay, say, the final result, okay, from the Kamland experiment. And you can see, okay, in this case, our observation, the experimental data, indeed is very different from, again, okay, say, the prediction if there were no neutrino oscillation. So in our data prefer in favor of, okay, neutrino oscillation. Now to convince ourselves indeed we have observed, okay, neutrino oscillation, then we can essentially, okay, use a different variable for the x-axis. So that now in this case, then we can see the pattern a lot better. So in this case, now we can see, indeed, we have, you know, okay, say, some kind of, okay, say, oscillatory behavior, you know, from the reactor anti-neutrinos. So Kamen, indeed, okay, was the first experiment showing that, you know, using human sources, we can see, okay, neutrino oscillation. So therefore, in some sense, okay, it's very unfortunate the Kamen result was not recognized by, you know, the Nobel Committee, okay, for this round. However, I believe, okay, this experiment, okay, is well deserved, okay, a Nobel Prize. So it may happen, okay, in the future. So now we understand, okay, the neutrino oscillation indeed, okay, can explain, okay, the solar neutrino problem. So then how about the atmospheric, okay, neutrinos? Now it turns out in this case, in order to confirm this hypothesis, we have to use, okay, accelerator. We have no choice because, okay, in this case, we have to produce, you know, a pure muon neutrino beam using, okay, say the, you know, say the machine. Now, altogether, okay, there were two experiments done in Japan. One is called, okay, K2K, which is finished already. And then the newer version is called, okay, the T2K, which is still ongoing. The only difference between these two experiments is that for the K2K experiment, they use an old proton accelerator, okay, in the suburb of the Tokyo. And then the new one, T2K, use a new accelerator right by, you know, the Pacific coastline. It's called, you know, the J-Park, you know, the accelerator complex. Then they send a beam all the way through Earth. Remember, the neutrinos, okay, that can go through this amount of, you know, say, rock without any trouble. And about, okay, 300 kilometer away, then they use, okay, the super chemokinetic detector to detect, you know, the arrival of the muon neutrino. This is, okay, how, you know, they do experiment. And now for T2K, it turns out it was the first generation of, okay, accelerator-based neutrino experiment to verify neutrino oscillation. So as a result, you can see, okay, that amount of data they got was rather poor. However, if we look at, okay, say the data point and then compare with, okay, say the prediction with no neutrino oscillation, you can see, okay, the prediction doesn't quite agree with the data point. The red curve, okay, represent, you know, neutrino oscillation as, okay, say obtained using, you know, the information from atmospheric, you know, the neutrino. So certainly, you know, the K2K, you know, okay, has a very strong indication, almost, okay, in evidence that, okay, the neutrino oscillation again can account for atmospheric, you know, the neutrino deficit. Now, for, okay, T2K, they have, okay, say essentially a more powerful neutrino beam. So as a result, you can see now in this case the difference between the data point and also, okay, the expectation of no oscillation is very, very different. So as a matter of fact, if we take the ratio between the two, then you can see, okay, say how much, okay, we have missed, you know, for the different energy of the neutrino. So as a result, know that, you know, K2K and T2K also, okay, receive the breakthrough prize, you know, recently. So now we have, okay, essentially two kinds of neutrino oscillations, and we have, you know, three kinds of, okay, neutrinos. So you may wonder, okay, in this case, whether, okay, we can have additional, okay, kind of neutrino oscillation. So which is representing, okay, by this curve. Because now we have done the Kamen experiment using, okay, reactor, then according to our current understanding of neutrino oscillation, then we speculate there could be another kind that would occur, okay, about 2 kilometers from, okay, say the nuclear reactor, which would be sitting, okay, say, you know, at zero. So then the question is, okay, does this, okay, say, new kind of neutrino oscillation exist or not? So this comes say the Diabe. So we are here, and the Diabe nuclear power plant, is sitting right over there. So which is roughly about 40 kilometers from where we are. So if we go to Diabe, you will see altogether there are three nuclear power plants. The Diabe nuclear power plant, and then Lingao and Lingao 2. So altogether we have six nuclear reactor, and this is extremely powerful. Probably among the top five most powerful nuclear reactor in the world. So as a result, we get a lot of anti-neutrinos for doing experiment. And furthermore, you can see that the one nice thing about power station is right by it is a hill, a big mountain range. So this is ideal for us to build an underground experimental facility to do the experiment. So this is the satellite view of the Diabe experiment. So what we do is we have two underground experimental sites which are only a few hundred meters from nuclear reactors. So these detectors are used to count the number of anti-neutrinos coming out from the reactors. And then about 2 kilometers deep into the mountain, then we have another station of detectors that can hold up to 4 detectors for us to count the number of anti-neutrino again. So since we have the known knowledge from the near detectors, so therefore we can forecast how many we should see at the far side if there's no neutrino oscillation. So from there, then we can tell whether we have another kind of reaction, neutrino oscillation or not. Now, if we look at the experimental hall, this is the drawing. So you can see for the near side, there are two detectors. And if we cut through it, then you see the target, which is the liquid scintillator, is sitting inside here. And this is about 5 meters tall and 5 meters in diameter. And this water pool is about 10 meters deep. So this is similar to the Olympic diving competition, the 10 meter diving pool. So it's about the same size. Now, so this is the far side. Altogether, it can hold 4 detectors. But in this picture, you can see we have installed 3 of them surrounded by ultra pure water, again to protect them from noise. Now, using experimental setup, then Diabe discover indeed there's a third kind of neutrino oscillation in 2012. And the most recent result that is published just recently, you can see now we use all together 8 detectors, 4 for the near sites and 4 for far site. And you can see when we count up the number of anti-neutrinos observed as a function of distance, then we do see less comparing with the expectation, which is 1. Okay. And also, if we now look at the energy distribution of all these events, then we find out the observed energy distribution again is different from the expectation with corresponding to no oscillation. So again, if you take ratio, then you can see the pattern a lot clearer. So from here, then as the professor Tai said, then we deduce essentially the values of one of the fundamental parameters of nature. Now, so what do we learn from all these experiments? So basically, it tells us something. In order for us to have neutrino oscillation, the neutrinos have to have mass. This is the most important message we get from this phenomenon. Of course, the phenomenon by itself is already a major surprise. And remember, in 1950 something, the Professor Li and Yang told us the neutrinos would be massless. And that was the cornerstone of the standard model in particle physics. However, because of the discoveries of neutrino oscillation, now we know, okay, the neutrinos are massive. So as a result, we have to, okay, throw away, okay, say this assumption. So now we have to go back to the drawing board and see, okay, how we are going to modify, okay, the, our understanding of, okay, particle physics. So this is, okay, the, you know, say the take home message. Now, since now we know the neutrinos have masses, and also at the beginning we said, okay, the whole universe is filled with neutrinos left over from, okay, the Big Bang. So as a result, now we have, okay, say this picture regarding the composition of the universe. And as we know now, we know, okay, the about 70% of, okay, the universe is made up of, okay, the dark energy that we have no idea what that is. And then about a quarter of them is dark matter. Again, okay, we don't know what that is. The remaining, roughly about 5% or so, are things, okay, we are more familiar with. So if we now, okay, look at, okay, say this small sector, which is, okay, less than roughly about 1% or so. If we look at it now, we know, okay, about 0.5% essentially are the luminous matter. That is, okay, the stars and so on, everything, okay, the we are fascinating with, okay, when we look at the night sky. However, look at that. Now neutrino is almost, okay, as, okay, abundant as stars, as far as, okay, mass is concerned. So this is certainly extremely, okay, say, the surprising. Now, so we have, okay, neutrino oscillation now, okay, essentially under the belt. So naturally, the question is, okay, what else, okay, the remainder to be discovered? So right now, one of the major burning questions relating to neutrino oscillation is related to, okay, what we call, okay, say CP violation. In other words, what we want to answer is whether or not the neutrino oscillates the same manner as, okay, say the antineutrino. So in order to answer this question, right at this moment, we are trying to mount a new experiment using a very intense, a new neutrino beam to be produced at Fermilab in the suburb of Chicago. We send the beam all the way through, okay, 1,300 kilometers to an underground facility in South Dakota. This is, okay, the old homestead mine used by Professor Davis, but we are now in the process of refurbishing this site so that we can essentially install a very gigantic detector made up of four modules. Each module is, okay, 10 kilometers filled with liquid argon. So this is, okay, the conceptual drawing of one of the module. So the idea is, okay, we will do this experiment roughly about, okay, the, you know, 2025, which is about 10 years from now. We will use, okay, neutrino beam, send it through, and see, okay, say if we start with the muon, by the time they get to, okay, the detector, see how many of them will become the electron type. And then after that, then we produce antineutrino beam, and then see, okay, how many of them will become, okay, say the anti-electron type. And then by comparing the two, then we want to know whether, you know, they are the same or not. Now, if the neutrino and the antineutrino do not behave the same way, then it might give us some clue about why, you know, the present universe is made up of only matter, but no antimatter. And remember, this is, okay, our existence, because, okay, if the universe were populated with the same amount of matter and antimatter, and when they run into each other, we will annihilate. We cannot survive. So that's why, okay, in this case, okay, the having, okay, say a matter dominant universe is crucial to our survival. And this might have something, okay, linked to the neutrino. So this is, okay, essentially the question, okay, we want to address in the future. So this is the end of my talk. Thank you.
Okay, I have two technical questions. Okay? The first one is that even if you bury your detector deep underground.
Yes.
But you still need to worry about those neutrinos produced by the rocks. Okay, you mentioned about the banana. Rocks, they definitely have them. Particularly for the case when you're checking, for example, in the solar source, the neutrinos, which is very far away, so the event is not that much. Now, for the Taiwan Bay, it's no problem because you produce huge amounts. So, so how you correct for those events coming from the rock? So that's the first technical question.
Yes.
Second one is when you produce a beam using accelerator, how do you direct the beam? Because as you say, the neutrino is very difficult to react to other things.
Yes.
And you cannot use an electric field accelerator to direct it. So how you direct it?
Okay. Yes. Okay, so let me answer the first question. You're correct. Indeed, there are neutrinos coming from the surrounding rock. As a matter of fact, this is one of the major discoveries of Kamlan, because the Kamlan is the first experiment that definitely observed neutrinos coming from Earth. So this is what we call a geoneutrino. It turns out the energy of those neutrinos is a lot smaller than say the one coming from the nuclear reactor. So therefore, even though they are there, but they will not affect us, because in this case, when we analyze the data, essentially we can just reject them. Okay, as a matter of fact, if we look back at the Kamlan result here. So you see that for Kamlan, reject events below this region. So we don't look at that. And it turns out for the one you talk about, they are all in this area. As a matter of fact, let me see whether I have that. You see here? Okay, this is geoneutrino. So this is taking that into account. So it's a very small number, comparing with coming from the reactor. Now, regarding the distinction of the geoneutrino from the solar neutrino, it turns out in this case, the reaction usually will give you the electron. In other words, it will kick the atomic electron out. And then if you look at the direction of the electron relative to the incoming direction of the neutrino, it has a very well-defined relationship. So as a result, for instance, the snow experiment or super K experiment, what they can do is essentially, they can essentially follow the sun. So every day we know where the sun is, right? Then they can essentially look at the data, relative to that. And then they find out essentially, there is events, essentially tracking the motion of the sun. So therefore those are really the solar neutrino. Right? Whereas the others, they will be independent of the time of the day. Now, then the second question is related to special relativity. It turns out the neutrinos produced by accelerators are coming from the pions and the kaons, moving very fast. And it turns out in the laboratory, when you look at those pion and kaon decays, then they are all relatively forward going. So in other words, it would be similar to the headlight of a car at night. So you see they just go in a cone. So therefore, we can tell where they are. Yeah.
How critical is it for the liquid to be clean? How clean does it?
It's a very good question. For Kamlan, essentially, we detected only one event per day. Even if we look at the 1 kiloton of liquid scintillator, as a result, the purity has to be better than 10 to the minus 16 gram per gram. So in other words, if you have 1 gram of liquid scintillator, then the impurity has to be less than 10 or minus 16 gram. So it's a very pure.
How difficult is it to maintain this level of cleanness?
That's a very good question. In the Kamlan experiment, we had essentially a small chemical plant underground. So every morning, the Japanese company will truck in, some amount of liquid scintillator, then essentially we had to run the plant through do all the purification before, okay, we fill the liquid scintillator. As a matter of fact, it took us, okay, so about 8 months to fill, okay, say this 10 kiloton of a detector. And then now for diabetes, it's a different story because in our case, even for the far side, we can detect about 100 anti-neutrino UN per day. So as a result, okay, the purity requirement is lower. Yeah. So we can essentially live with about 10 to the minus 11, minus 12 gram per gram.
So for your proposed experiment from Fermi to South Dakota,
yes.
So how is it run?
Well, it turns out in this case, we use a different technology. Let me show you here. So in this case, we will essentially use liquid argon. In this case, what happens is when we have, a charged particle inside, then it will ionize the argon atoms. And then by applying, okay, say, the electric field through, okay, electrodes, okay, probably you may not be able to see, you can see a lot of those fine lines there. So essentially, this is, okay, like, okay, you know, electric cage. So the, just imagine like a capacitor. So you have an anode and cathode, and then in between you fill with liquid, you know, argon. So after the ionization, the electron and the argon ion, under the influence of the electric field, okay, they will drift. So what we do is, okay, essentially we drift the electron, and then using, okay, essentially, okay, some wires, then we can pick up, you know, the signal. And then from there, then essentially we can see the track. Unfortunately, I forgot not to prepare, okay, one slide to show you. So this is a very advanced technology. Probably it will still take some time, you know, to master it. So therefore, there's, okay, some risk involved. However, you know, hopefully, you know, in a few years, then we can essentially, okay, master, you know, the entire technique. Then we can then do the experiment.
And what is the budget for this project?
Wow, you will ask, okay, the most important question.
This is cheap in high energy physics.
Yes. This is over $1 billion.
Yeah. And the Congress will support it?
Right now, because, okay, this is still relatively new. The international collaboration is formed only roughly about a year ago. So at this moment, US is negotiating with CERN and also the other European countries, because this is a major collaboration between essentially Europe and US. Yeah. So in the US, a few years ago, we were told US could contribute about three-quarter of $1 billion to the project. So for the remaining half or so, we have to, you know, say, get it from, you know, say, Europe. And also now that India has a lot of interest, so certainly they will also contribute.
Oh, thank you for your talk. I want to ask, if neutrino has mass, then why is the maximum energy, kinetic energy of beta decay not lower in that case?
Oh, well, it will be lower, right? Because, okay, if we go back there, oops. Here. So, because, okay, remember, no, the reaction is this, right, here, right? So if this one, no, doesn't have, okay, say, any mass, then, because, okay, back one step. Because, okay, when, say, the parent decays, then it will release a certain amount of energy, right? And that energy is, okay, essentially the kinetic energy shared by this free particle if, say, this, okay, were massless, right? However, if, say, this one has, okay, some finite mass, then naturally, okay, say, then the amount of, okay, say, kinetic energy available to, let's say, the three daughters will be a little bit less, right? So that's the reason why then you see, okay, say the turnover like that. So because this one, okay, the represent, okay, say the maximum, right? So we can imagine, okay, in this case, the maximum is, they go back to back like that, right?
But why did that?
The mass is too small.
Yeah, it's very small, right?
Mass is the reason, the three states of the oscillator. That the reason? The mass coupled, the mass of the neutrino makes this oscillation, right?
Okay. you asked a question that I try to avoid, in this talk. Because, we have been focusing on, the three types of neutrinos we observe in the laboratory. However, in order to really formulate neutrino oscillation, we have to introduce, another new concept called, neutrino mixing. So it turns out, in this case, each neutrino favor, the electron, muon, the tau type, we absorb in laboratory, actually is a linear combination of three states. And, the mass, we are talking about, are the masses related to, the mass, the states.
So the mass coupled is three states.
Exactly, yeah.
So in that sense, then, if the neutrino pass through different material, this coupling will be different?
It does. So that's the reason why, remember I show you, about the sun? Let's go, wrong way. Sorry about that. One more. By the way, this is the other Nobel Prize, right here. So you see here, so this is as I mentioned, this corresponds to pretty dense the region, and it does affect. Yeah. So as a matter of fact, this is what we call the meta effect.
Okay. So last question. So you guys was awarded $3 million. So how you are going to share?
Well, it's not done by us. Okay, the foundation has already decided how to split it up.
Yeah, but for your individual hand.
No. As I say, it's done by the collaboration. It's not done by collaboration. It's done by the foundation. Yeah. So if you have 10 people, then you divide. By 10. If you have 200, then you divide by 200.
So what's that number?
You can look it up, So you if you care about money, then science, I can tell you. So the five experiments, each experiment, will have 600,000. Okay. The leaders, depending on which experiment, we have a larger share. And then the remaining will be divided among the collaborators.
Congratulations.
Okay. Any scientific questions?
I hope it's for the science.
Okay. As a follow-up to the question about the budget for the experiment, I want to know the time scale. And is in the same question, can you say something quickly about the Juno physics, the time scale and the budget?
Okay. For doing that is the new experiment I mentioned. The plan is we will install the first 10 kiloton detector underground to start doing physics without beam. And then by 2025, then we'll do the beam part.
And then for Juno, what's the time scale budget and what's
Juno,
the physics?
Right now, they plan to start in 2020. Okay. Now, however, I should point out that there's very little overlap between Juno and Dune.
Yeah, so what's the physics of Juno?
Juno is trying not to answer the question, you know, whether, you know, say among the three, you know, say masses, which one, okay, is the heaviest. But this is what we call the mass hierarchy, as you know, right? And then for Dune, if, okay, say Juno hasn't seen or resolved that, then definitely Juno will, I mean Dune, okay, will essentially resolve that with 100% certainty. Because, okay, essentially you can see very clearly, you know, that yeah, that difference between.
And do you know the budget for Juno?
Juno, a couple years ago, the estimate was $300 million US dollars.
Okay. I just say that Juno is another neutrino experiment, which is very close to Hong Kong, Guangdongshan. So, okay. Due to the limit of time, let's thank Professor Luk for a beautiful talk.